keep it close enough. Okay, we'll call the meeting to order. If you'd like to stand and join for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Agenda review?
Nothing
to add? Okay, we have the minutes to approve for the deliberative session on February 1st.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, moved and seconded to approve the deliberative session minutes. Any areas, corrections, omissions that anybody would like to make?
I just wanted to point out that there are a few typos in here.
Yeah.
So I will have those corrected. There's one on one that says GWRSD and it should say New Hampshire. One that says shirk and it's shirt and it should say shirk. One that says differs and it should say deferred. Another one where deferred needs to be added. So they're all minor things, but they do need to be corrected.
Okay. Well, motion to approve with the spelling corrections as indicated.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Chair votes aye. Thank you. Minutes of the school board meeting from February 3rd at Tuckman River Central School.
Second.
Okay, moved and seconded to approve the minutes of the Tuckman River School Board meeting, or the school meeting at Tuckman River on the 3rd. Any errors, omissions, corrections on that one? Yes, sir.
A couple here under the catch E minutes on the second page. We've written it as cat migra, so cat migra.
Okay.
Under the motion. And then under A chairman's report, let's see, Mr. Widner said get sympathy wishes. I think it was either going to be get well or sympathy, so a minor typo
yeah.
there.
Yeah.
That's it.
Okay, thank you. Okay, all those in favor with those corrections? Signal by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Any abstentions? Chair votes aye as well. And the manifests for today that are being signed are from our last school board meeting to March 6th. And the total for the manifest is $4,029,854.12.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, moved and seconded to approve the manifests that are being signed tonight in the total of $4,029,854.12. All those in favor, signal by saying aye.
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 Opposed? Chair votes aye. Thank you. Okay, public input. It's an opportunity for the public to ask some questions or address the board on any concerns. There'll be another 15-minute opportunity at the end of the meeting as well. Yes, sir.
Thank you. For the record, Ed Camo, representing Brookfield, Wakefield, and Ossie and Effingham. I just wanted to report to you there was a stakeholder meeting this morning in reference to the fire and how to go forward with bringing some stuff together from state partners, etc., to help out. The question I had was, is there something in place to make sure the students that were picked up from that location are being still delivered to school? Is that in place?
Absolutely. There's actually quite a bit in place for those students. Transportation is in place. They have free breakfast, free lunch. We've done some fundraising for clothing. And they have backpacks as part of 68 Hours of Hunger for weekends. And they also have counseling. So I think the only thing we haven't done is housing. So if someone else can help them with housing, that would be wonderful.
I would suggest that you appoint someone to the committee that's being formed to figure out transportation, housing, et cetera, be a part of that as a community. You can just perhaps appoint somebody to that committee. It's being formed now, and that will be coming up in the next few weeks.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, anyone else? Okay, moving on to student representative report. Connor.
All right, so we're going to get started off with Winter Carnival. Fantastic Winter Carnival. Sadly, the seniors did not win this year. But we did win the lip sync, and that's all we care about. So, otherwise, good Winter Carnival. First things up in March is Cynthia's Challenge, March 13th and 14th, 24-hour skiing. It's a great time for a great cause. And I suggest if you don't have a ski, you just go, you know, go for skiing a couple hours. It'd be fun. So, up next was the end of winter sports. Only one team is in the playoffs, and it's boys basketball, and they're playing at, I'm not sure, somewhere far away tonight. I know that much. That's why I'm not going there. And hopefully we'll come back with a win.
Okay.
So, and for winter, for other winter sports, the ski team for Kingswood brought back two ski meshes for both boys and girls, senior Allie Bean and sophomore Robbie Hotchkiss. So,
nice.
It was really great. What else is there? Oh, the reason why I was almost late today and why I'm not in my usual attire is at the start of spring sports is upon us. So, I was at lacrosse practice.
Great. I appreciate you being here anyway.
Thank you. And that should be it for March.
Great. Thank you very much, Connor.
Yeah.
Okay. Superintendent.
I'm going to try to get the microphone on here. Testing. I don't know if I can. The button. There we go. Hello?
Yeah.
It's on. Okay. I know my voice is very soft, so I know people might not be able to hear me if I don't use a microphone. So, therein, I'm going to use the mic. I'd like to say it's always wonderful to be here in Ossipee, and I talked with Andrea a little bit. Actually, we had a lot of conversation last week around the fire in Ossipee, and I think Andrea is going to talk a little bit tonight about how the community has come together to support those families. So you'll be hearing about that. I also am fascinated to see what the kids are doing tonight, because I had a little bit of conversation with Andrea about that, and I think it's going to be a great presentation, so I'm looking forward to it. So, Andrea?
Good evening, everyone, and welcome school board members, staff, and our community members and students. We're so pleased to have you here tonight and to let you know how proud we are of our community. Many of you do know that we had a devastating fire last week that affected a lot of our families, or some of them. This community has come together to support these families in every way possible, from the numerous donation sites to the monetary donations, and of course the generosity of the school district's transportation department. I think that highlights, you know, how we work together as a community to support our families. So, you know, I'm thanking everyone within the community along with the school district. One way that we support our students here at OCS is being safe, responsible, and respectful. Our sixth graders work hard to honor our motto, and some students go above and beyond to become peer helpers. And so we actually do have some peer helpers here today. Peer helpers give our younger students guidance through helping them through transitions, giving tours if we have new students, setting an example of positive behavior throughout our school. Students are also encouraged to set and achieve high academic goals. We want our students to take pride in their work so they become collaborative partners in learning. So tonight you'll see some of our sixth graders present a science, engineering, and energy project that they have thoroughly enjoyed, and I know that all of you will as well. So we have Mrs. LaFave. She is one of our sixth grade teachers this year.
I'll try to project as much as possible too. My voice is on the softer side, so if anyone can't hear me, just flag me and I'll try to yell louder. We have six representatives today from a combination of our two sixth grade classes who volunteered to come out tonight. Thank you, family, for getting them here to present comment about their work they've been doing in science. I teach science for both classes and math, so this activity incorporated science, technology, engineering, and math all together. It's known as STEM, which is an acronym that stands for those four subjects. So although this was happening in science class, students were using math, they were using engineering, they were using technology on the computer all the time. So we have a pasta card design project, so six of you would mind in front. And I'd like to just let them take a moment to introduce themselves. We'll start at the end. If you could just share your first name and the class you belong to.
Hi, I'm Alyssa, and I'm in 6th grade.
Hi, I'm Marley.
Nice and loud, guys.
Hi, I'm Carmody, and I'm in 6th grade.
Hi, I'm Maya, and I'm 6th grade.
Hi, I'm Hope, and I'm in 6MD.
Hi, I'm William, and I'm in 6MD.
Alyssa, you want to take it over with the summary of the project? Yep, you can come on up and kind of speak out front, even though you're looking at that kind of
term. Pasta card design was a voices in motion concept. The idea was to work with a partner to create a car or a vehicle that would go down a ramp and meet three standards: speed, distance, and design. We were able to paint them at the end for the design part, and you just had to basically build it till it met speed and distance.
Cool. Thank you. There were first, second, third place winning teams. They were in partners assigned by me with some input by them. We had three winners for speed, distance, and creative design. Step one. Nice and loud.
Step one was submit and design a proposal. And what we did is we drew a design of our car. And face style cars after that, but the result wasn't the same as the sketch. It was just
And they could see the pasta that was available to them beforehand, so as they sketched, they were directed to try to label and be as explicit as possible and make sure they could create a car that was within their budget. So they had a budget of amounts they could spend, and each piece of pasta cost this, we called them derby dollars, cost a certain amount of derby dollars, so they had to create their design to work within a certain budget.
Step two. So we used our derby dollars to purchase supplies and build our car, different pasta and craft objects. Cost different prices, so, and we had access to glue, so we could actually build the car. We went off of our sketches mostly, so it wouldn't look exactly like the sketch, but we were close to that.
Okay. And just to be honest, how many of your cars look exactly like your sketch?
Not at all,
right?
No.
Which, that was the point, and I told them, feel free to venture out. What you design in your mind might not travel at all. There might be too much friction between the ramp. And we had some that designed something, built it, set it on the ramp, and it just stood there and didn't move at all. I said, okay, well, we need less friction. Or more mass, or something like that, so they would experiment and try a little bit. They did have to have a mass that was between 50 and 75 grams. We talked about fairness, and when you enter a competition, whether it be wrestling, football, car racing, you need to have certain specs to make it fair. So we said between 50 and 75 grams would be a fair weight so that people weren't sending one piece of pasta down the ramp and calling it their car, because the light mass would travel far. Okay, step three.
Step three was the time trials. We would have to have 4 time trials to get to the competition. Which is, the time trial is where you put your car onto the ramp and then you take a timer and you time how long it takes for the car to get from the top to the bottom of the ramp.
They also needed to measure, once it hit the bottom, they stopped the timer and measured how far in meters the car traveled. So they wanted to maximize speed and then distance. So they took 2 measurements every time they ran it. There's a top view of the ramp going down, and you can see the meter stick kind of coming out. Race day, step 4.
So on race day, there was winners for both speed, distance, and creative design. And there were 2 brackets. There was one that you could win, and there was one that we called the loser bracket. And you weren't really like a loser, but you were like, you didn't win.
Say so, bottom bracket.
It's bottom bracket.
And this is a picture of one class, the final designs. We put up we numbered them, and we had 5 adults in the building come in and do their votes for top design. So they weren't biased toward whose was whose, and we had a kind of a blind vote and determined winners for design. Speed and distance were more easy objective to calculate, so we did that ourselves. There's one class, and then the second class renditions are here. And this is just, we learned about double elimination brackets, and that's what she was talking about. We have a top bracket, and we learned that if you do lose round one and you go down to your bottom bracket, if you do well in bottom bracket, you could eventually come back and verse the winning, and that happened a couple times. They'd go into the bottom bracket, do a second round, and they'd come back and they'd match somebody from the top bracket. So there's some double elimination. And we figured out first, second, and third place through this approach. Okay. For the last couple of minutes, if Carmen, do you want to start? And Carmen D. and Alyssa were partners. They'll just kind of show their car and just talk. Can you mention your favorite part of the project and the most difficult part?
Yeah, you can go up in the middle.
So my favorite part was trying to come up with a design to originally start our car and be able to sketch it and have a plan in mind that we knew probably wouldn't work, but it was fun to try it anyway. It was fun to see what would work and what wouldn't. It took us a while to figure out a couple of things.
And the most difficult part of the project for us, I would say it would be our wheels. We wanted them to roll at first, but it just didn't work. So we had to make them slide instead.
Yeah. Plus, we figured out when we glued on the straws, actually melted it, and the glue was actually sliding on the ramp, so we had to cut out this part. So it was just the dowel that was showing, so that way it wouldn't slow down our car.
Interesting.
So.
What was the biggest thing that you learned from your sketch to actually putting your car on the track?
That what we thought was going to work did not work at all.
And so did you learn that was okay?
Yeah.
Sometimes you have to go through things.
The mistake actually helped us figure out what was going to be our next step, because if we hadn't made a mistake the first time, then we never would have been able to make it better, so it could have gotten faster and got longer distance.
So you had to figure out
what you did that could be improved?
Yes.
Is that? Thank you.
You want to say how you lost that and then maybe not every single day?
So what we did was, we had a daily log, and we would put the date on a Google Doc, and it was like a graph, kind of. And we put the date and then what we accomplished that day, and like what improvements we did, or what we have to do next time.
Great. Thank you.
Thanks a lot.
And when we did the time trial log, like Hope was saying, you actually have to fit, after you do the log, you have to write down what you want to fix for next time. So after every time trial, you had to figure out what you need to fix so then you can make it better.
Excellent. Thank you.
Thank you.
This was our font. The funnest part was probably putting all the pieces together with the hot glue.
The hardest part was working with someone and that you couldn't, like, if she was doing something to the car, like, I couldn't just go over and do something. And the other part was that people kept coming over and using our stuff and, like, breaking it. And so that's when I was like, okay, you need to stop and we're going to, like, fix this real quick. And another hard part was not knowing, like, knowing that you didn't have enough money to go buy stuff that you really needed. So that's kind of hard.
Mm-hmm. So that's...
Can you explain how you earn money? Because I don't think we talked about that. So, how you earn money is you can help other people, and there's, like, quizzes. And so every time you get, like, one right, you'll get, like, one or two. And then if I got all, like, if I was to have 10 questions and I got all of them right and she got all of hers right, we'd have $20 in all. And another way how you can earn them is, oh yeah, teamwork. So if I... So if she didn't talk about something, I could go over and help her and then we earn like 5 extra.
Nice.
Great.
Wonderful.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
So this is my card. As you can see, it has a lot of glue on it. My favorite part about making the card was just like planning out the design. Like just see how it would look before we actually made it. And the toughest part for me was, like, I think just actually, like, designing the car so it would reach the weight requirements.
Okay.
Thank you.
So, this is my car. It kind of fell apart. Left it on the standing table. It fell apart. So I think my favorite part was probably getting to build it. And, like, I think my least favorite part was probably having to try to repair it. That's pretty much it.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Students are still working on... They not only did they log every day, they did a Wii video, so they're it's called logging, so they're doing a video log. So they're taking an app called Wii Video and doing just panorama videos of their car. They did it on all the 5 or 6 days we worked on it, and they're in the process of compiling those little truncated short videos into a virtual evolution of their design. So they have a picture of their design starting the video, day one, what they did on day one, they can narrate the video, and they're doing transitions and just video logging their entire process. And then the final part is to, they haven't started this part yet, but they're going to come up with an advertisement to market their design using the vocabulary from Forces in Motion. How did you reduce friction? How did you increase acceleration? So the hard part's still coming.
That's great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
wants to look. They're out, all the, even the ones who weren't here to participate, all the different cars are out for view now or later. You want to come up and take a break and look at the work.
Are any of these kids the winners from any of the brackets, like this or top?
There was Ian Kremity got second place for painting.
Thank you. Maybe you would forward that video to the SAU office. We'd love to see it. Okay. And then I can share it with the board. So thank you very much. That was wonderful. You're certainly all welcome to stay. On the other hand, if you want to get your children home to bed, that's certainly fine. Thank you for coming. Well, on to the next part of our agenda. I'm pleased to have John Tobin here with us tonight. And John is going to explain the amicus brief being filed with the New Hampshire Supreme Court regarding school funding and to discuss whether or not there is interest on the part of this board with regard to signing on to support it. So, John, thank you for being here.
Thank you for having us. That was really sweet, and it's sort of a hard act to follow. So this is my colleague, Natalie LaFlamme, who's also a lawyer. We're going to only take about 10 minutes of your time. We're going to tell you about the Condell case, about what an amicus brief, a friend of the court brief, is, and talk a little bit about what we plan to say in that brief, and also who else is involved. And let me start with that. At this point, what we are trying to do is put in a brief, an argument in the Condell case in support of the school districts that brought that case and other school districts. And so what we set out to do was get a range of school districts around the state who would sign on to the brief so that we could show the court that this is not just a problem in southwestern New Hampshire. So we have a range of districts who've already agreed to sign on, ranging from Berlin in the north, Derry, Concord, Hopkinton, Merrimack Valley, Mascoma, White Mountain Regional, Newport, Claremont, Haverhill, and we met today with folks in Manchester, and we're reasonably confident that they may join as well, and we're talking to some others as well. So you can see it's kind of small districts, big districts, all over the state. So the Condell case is a case brought by the Contoocook Valley Regional School District, a big regional school district like this one, and some other smaller districts joined it to challenge the state's funding formula. And they tried to do it in a sort of surgical strike. They didn't challenge the whole system. They basically were saying to the court, there's some things left out of the formula. Please, court, tell the state to put them back in the formula and then write us a check right away. They were hoping to get that order before June 30th so they could get that money for the current school year. The court, the trial court, the Superior Court, agreed with them that the formula was flawed and found not just that there were pieces missing, but that the whole formula was irrational and flawed. And so the court struck down that formula. And this is the formula that right now says that basic adequacy can be covered for $3,709 plus the little increments. But the court did not order any payments. The court stepped back, as courts usually do, and say, it's not our job to appropriate money. It's up to the legislature to figure out how to resolve this, and basically said respectfully to the legislature, you need to get on this. The state appealed that decision, and so that case is now pending in the New Hampshire Supreme Court. And the school district's brief is due on April 16th, and we are generally going to support the school districts, so our brief is also due April 16th. And we have some other things that we want to say. That in the Condell case, they didn't focus as much on the property tax problem as, in my view, perhaps they should have, because that's an equal pillar to this problem. So we want to tell the court that, number one, the problems with the formula don't just affect a few districts. They affect all the districts. And we're going to give them examples about how that plays out in a bunch of different sized districts. We're also going to point out that the other pillar of the Claremont case, and I worked on the Claremont case, and my part of it was on the property tax side, was that one of the pillars of that case is whatever tax the state picks to fund education, the rate is supposed to be the same across the state. And I sent you a few of our slides from our Wolfboro presentation. You can see that even within this district, which is relatively speaking a property well-off district, there are disparities in terms of the equalized value per pupil and therefore the tax rates. So you can have two children, one from Effingham and one from Tuftonboro, sitting in the same class, getting the same education because you're spending the same amount of money, but their parents are paying very different tax rates. And that's because our system relies utterly on the equalized value within municipal boundaries that were drawn 200 years ago. So it ends up with very, very different tax rates for the same education. So we're going to point that out to the court. And we're also going to point out one of the things that we've learned and we've seen. I've been part of about 75 presentations around the state since June of 2018. Again, all over the place. And we've learned a lot from those forums. And the original idea, this was before the Condell case was formed, was to bring this discussion back into the public debate and discourse. Because ultimately, it has to be decided through our democratic institution. Even if the Condell folks get a favorable decision from the New Hampshire Supreme Court, the legislature is still going to have to design the remedy. So, we want to point out to the court a couple of things. One is that this problem has gotten a lot worse in the last decade. The state has really retreated from supporting education in a lot of ways, and I don't have to tell you that. In terms of retirement costs, in terms of all kinds of things, the state has retreated. And the number is, in the last, from 2008 to 18, school budgets went up by almost $600 million, and more than 500 of that was borne by property taxpayers. The state really didn't chip in to bear much of any of those costs. The problem has also gotten worse because the equalized value disparities are a lot worse. And finally, we have a slide, and this may also be of interest to you. The gaps in teacher salaries between the salaries in a place like Pittsfield and the salaries in a place like Rye have gotten even worse. They were different in 2008, but the gaps have grown. So the problem has gotten worse, and it affects all different school districts all around. So what we're asking of you is not to pay us any money, because we're doing this pro bono, and not to make a commitment to join the Condell case, because we're not doing that. It's just an opportunity for a bunch of other school districts to inform the court about this problem and to let the court know that it's a problem that exists all over the place and it's gotten worse. My colleague Natalie is going to talk a little bit more in detail about what an amicus is in the court and how we fit in.
Yeah, so amicus, some people say amicus. I actually don't know which is right because people say it differently every time, but that's what we are. And as John said, it's a friend of the court, so it's supporting one side, but it's really to help the court, give them more information, present additional arguments. And courts generally like to see these briefs. A court likes to have more information before they decide, and especially in kind of bigger, more important cases, one of the other things we're really trying to do and why we're trying to get so many different schools on board is to really show the importance of this issue and how widespread it is. And so amicus briefs can also really send a message to the court, and that's kind of one of our big things. So amici aren't parties to the case, but you have some interest in it. And by not being a party, it means that you don't directly benefit from it. And by that, I mean, in Condell, for example, the plaintiffs asked the court for a amount of money for the state to pay them. So if this went up to appeal or back to trial court and Conval and those schools were ultimately awarded money, an amicus doesn't get any of that because they weren't a party. However, you benefit by whatever funding formula might result from this case, or if there was another lawsuit in the future, this kind of sets the groundwork for that, that you did want to join. So you do benefit, but it's not a direct, you know, from this case. And I think John said this too, it is a limited commitment. It's really, it's just this one brief when it's on appeal. You're not signing up to be part of the Conval suit if it goes back to the court, trial court after the appeal, or if it goes on for 5 years. It's really just this one brief, that's it. If you want to do more later, that's up to you. But, and John said we were doing this pro bono.
Yeah.
People usually want to know that.
Yeah, they want to know that first. So let me just take you quickly through the six slides. And the first one is simply a model resolution that a number of the school districts who signed on have adopted. And, you know, as you will see in that resolution, it makes plain, number one, there's no cost. Number two, there's no ongoing long-term commitment. Then the other slides are slides that came from the presentation that we did in Wolfboro last May. And the first one is a slide that shows the equalized value per pupil in the six towns in the school district, and it shows what the tax rate is. And that tax rate, tax rates are set locally, but the Department of Revenue Administration has a mechanism to equalize them so you can compare them. It's a very reliable mechanism. And this tax rate includes the local school tax and the statewide property tax. So that's the total of those two tax rates. And again, you can see, and this plays out across the state, and I'll show you another slide about that in a minute, Effingham, which has a much lower equalized value, and the average last year was about a little over $1 million. These are figures from 2017, 2018. It was a little over $1 million. So New Durham was just a little above average, Ossipee a little higher than that, Brookfield a little higher than that, and Tuftonboro and Wolfboro much higher than that, and Effingham was considerably below the average. And you can see that, and these tax rates take into account the state aid that was provided. The differentials would be even greater, but for the fact that there was state aid provided in those years. So then the next one is a slide that just shows what does this mean to homeowners. And I recognize, and so what we tried to do was say, what are the taxes on a $200,000 home in different places? And I recognize that there aren't too many $200,000 homes left anymore, but it does still show you the differences in the tax bills from town to town because of the value or less value of the property. And so the consequences of our current system, even in a district where everybody's getting the education together. And I know that, you know, that part of the history of this school district is Moultonboro, which is even much higher on the charts than Tuftonboro and Wolfboro, left this district. And I can tell you that across the state, there is a lot of tension within regional school districts between the towns that have a high value and the ones that have a low value. And that's because under the current scheme, it's every town for itself. And so one of the questions we get in our presentations is, in this era of declining enrollment, doesn't it make sense for school districts to do what you did a generation ago or several generations ago, and that's regionalize and get efficient? And unfortunately, the current system discourages that. So there aren't any new regionalizations being formed. More, the other thing that's happening is there's a lot of tension within them and a lot of push to break up, even in the Conval district, for instance. So there are a lot of good reasons, especially again with declining enrollment, to keep what you have here, which is a regional district where you share resources and kids get to see each other, and you can have broader course offerings. But the tax system pushes people in the other direction, unfortunately. So the other slides are a couple slides that step out and beyond your school district, and just show you even more the enormous variation in equalized value per pupil. And the first one just shows that those value, that can be true in a big district or a small district. And you can see in Moultonboro's more than, and this is 2017, 2018, more than $6 million per kid. That's the value of the property they have that they can tax. Whereas Claremont, Berlin, you know, 1/15th, 1/18th of that. So that means even with state aid, they have to pay much higher taxes and they can afford less. So the next one takes those same towns and looks at the tax rates and the bills on a $200,000 piece of property. And again, you can see there's Moultonboro, tax rate of $4.07, $814 bill, and then go up a little bit to Claremont, it's almost $5,000 for the same value of the property because there's less to tax, so they have to reach, they have to dig in deeper to what's there in order to raise the same. It's a math, it's a function of math. So what it means is that there are a lot of places in the state where the taxpayers, even with limited means, are sacrificing a great deal. One of the main lessons that I've learned from doing this in the last year and a half is how across the state so many people in towns like this are sacrificing a lot for their kids. They're paying really high rates. And then the last one sort of puts one more piece of data there, and that's how much is being spent per pupil. And these, again, for the towns in your district, it's the same amount. You put all the money in a pot and you spend the same. And even with that, the tax rates vary. And again, so you can look at Moultonboro, low tax rate, but they're able to spend $25,000 per kid. Claremont, a much higher tax rate, but they're only able to spend $16,000 per kid because the property value is so, the difference is it's not 20%, it's not 200%, it's almost 2,000%. So if you get a lot of aid in Claremont, it's really impossible to make up that enormous difference in property values. So this system operates and hurts in different ways. One of the things we've learned is that it discourages economic development and even maintenance in the property poor districts because rational business people say, well, why should I open a new business in Claremont or Berlin where the tax rates are high and the schools are shaky? So there's a lot of other collateral harms. One of the other ones is we all recognize more than we did 25 years ago that we need to attract young people. We have a problem of an aging demographic and not keeping or retaining enough young families. Property taxes are a burden to that. And in many districts, they also discourage town leaders from welcoming new housing because they figure we're on our own. If we build new housing and we have more kids, it's all going to be on us, or it's mostly going to be on us. And that doesn't make sense. So there are a lot of things about this that if you care about education and some sort of educational equity you care about, if you care about economic development, you should care about this. And if you care about the demographic future of the state, you should care about this. So those are all some of the things we're going to talk about in our brief. Happy to answer any questions you have. Again, not asking you to take a position on any tax or any political anything. It's really basically we're trying to send a message to the court. The system is broken and it's unfair, and we want you, court, to tell the legislature to fix it within these principles.
So I do have a question then.
Yeah.
From the standpoint of what maybe the Conville case is looking to do with the state, are they looking to equalize the tax rate as opposed to using the equalized value of the property? Is that their goal?
Well,
to make sure that you equalize the tax rate so a poorer community will get a much higher percent of the money than everybody getting the same number? Is that their goal?
There are two goals, and one of them is that the state, right now, the state pays only about 20% of the cost of education, and property taxpayers pay 75%. including the statewide property tax and the local tax. So goal number one is to have the state really pay for the true cost of an education. Goal number two is not to pick a tax, but just to say to the legislature, whatever tax you pick, the rate has to be the same to pay for this core. And the Supreme Court has made it clear that different towns have different needs. This district is going to need to spend more money on transportation than Manchester does. Manchester has, and I think you have it too, but Manchester has over 50% kids in poverty. So they have different needs. So the court said, you need to meet the needs in each district, and those needs are not going to be the same. They may cost different amounts. But whatever tax you pick, or whatever combination of taxes you pick, to pay for that core, the rate has to be the same. So you were sounded like you were going toward a statewide property tax with the same rate. That's a choice. They could do all different kinds of things. The court is not going to make that choice, right? And we're not going to ask them to make that choice. That's a choice that belongs to our elected representatives. I'm looking at one.
Yeah.
And so, but we need to send the elected representatives the message that, and it's an interesting, in some ways it's a very conservative message politically. We have oppressive taxes in certain places in the state where the government's reach into those households in Claremont and Berlin is enormous. And so we need to do something to back off the government in those places. And that's, you know, we have this, that whole thing rests in a thing in our Constitution about the taxes are supposed to be proportional and reasonable. That came from the American Revolution, where the British Crown was imposing oppressive taxes. So that thing that John Adams wrote in there is a principle of saying taxes have to be proportional and reasonable. They can't be this skewed and they can't be this uneven and so difficult. So that, but we're not proposing a remedy. It's up to the legislature to do that. The court just needs to give the legislature a nudge.
Anyone else have any questions?
You look like you have a question.
No, John, actually, I don't. I heard the presentation when you've been in Wolfboro last time.
Really?
I didn't disagree with it then, so I'm not going to disagree with it now.
Good. I'm glad I'm consistent. That's good.
I think it's helpful because it does paint a good picture. I mean, we've talked about it, but certainly it paints a picture of what things are looking like, and not just for us, because some kind of look at, well, it's just Governor Wentworth that's dealing with this. It's not. It's the entire state that's...
I did a presentation in a little town called Marlow the other night, and the three things that break my heart about this problem came up, one after the other. One was some young parents there really wanting their schools to be quality, and some elderly citizens, and I'm an elderly citizen, I get it, saying we can't keep paying. And then another one was they're a little district and a family moved in with a special needs kid that blew up their budget. And in other places, that cost would be spread out over the whole state or over the whole county. But in a little place like Marlow or a district like this, it hits hard, and that creates animosity toward that family and resentment. Why are they getting so much money and my kids, whatever is being cut? So, this creates pain and tension in a lot of places. And people, and this is town meeting time, people tend to blame that on the school board or the board of selectmen. Why can't you be more frugal? Why can't you do whatever? You can't, because the system is set up. You can't impose any different taxes. You can't change town lines. So we're trying to get people to see beyond their town lines, to see this is playing out in a lot of places and it needs to be fixed.
John, when do you need to know by?
Our plan is to try to get a draft of our brief to people by March 24th, which is 2 weeks. And that draft will be the draft of the text. It won't have all the lovely tables of cases and all that sort of stuff on it. Then ask for people to get us feedback within about a week. This has to be absolutely filed and beautiful on April 16th. So we would really like to know by April 1st at the latest, if that's possible.
So Do you want to look at a copy of the draft first and then discuss it? Our next board meeting is early April. You know, we probably not get to you by April 1st.
That's okay. If you get to us by April 16th, if you get to us by April 9th, that would give us a good chance.
Our next board is right on the agenda. Our next board meeting is April 6th. So we, I think we'd probably, the board would probably be able to get back to you through me on April 7th.
Great. And if in the meantime you have any questions of any of us, let us know. If you feel like you need more information or you have other questions, please let us know. And I wanted to thank Linda Murphy for helping set this up and make copies at the last minute. Anything else?
Well, I appreciate you being here. It is very informative, and you're right. There's a lot of tension in all these cooperative districts, and we face the same thing.
Yeah.
You know, you look at the tax rates in some of the towns, and you certainly have to feel for those towns paying the higher tax rates. But then you look at the per pupil cost that some of the more wealthy towns are, and you've got this disparity there. You know, I'm paying so much up here, and you're paying here. Yeah. Your tax rate is way up here, and ours is down here. You know, you've got that balance, and it's very difficult.
It is a tough
position to be in. So.
Well, thank you for hearing us out.
Thank you.
And also, thank you for doing your job. I have a lot more appreciation than I ever did before for the job of being a school board.
Well, thank you. We appreciate that very much. Thank you, John.
Thank you. Paul Mikulski is here with us tonight, and he's going to give us an update on our IT department. You know that he's done lots and lots of work on the infrastructure, and that has resulted in some very cost-effective measures that we're starting to see the benefit of. And I wouldn't do that explanation justice because there's so much that's technical here. So we definitely needed Paul to be here tonight. So thank you so much, Paul, for coming.
Well, we're moving right along since the last time I met you. We were experiencing a lot of system failures, old servers, old switching. All of the networks in all of the elementary schools, all the switches have been upgraded from the 10-100 switches to the gig switches. This is district-wide. Wi-Fi is 95-97% complete for high-speed, high-density Wi-Fi in every building. We have just a handful more to hang down in New Durham, and then we'll be finished with the Wi-Fi. We've also we did a dark and lit fiber connection last summer, so all of the elementary schools are now connected back to the data center at the high school. And initially, they were all, I call them little lost children out there, all by themselves with their own firewalls and all of that. Now, we've managed to eliminate those six firewalls. We're down to the one firewall plus our spare. If the main one goes down, we're able to just plug in and just bring up another firewall. The lit fiber, that's been great for testing because we've also increased data speeds. It's 300 megabytes synchronous for all the elementary schools, where Effingham and Tuftonboro previous were 65 by 2, so 65 megs down and 2 up, which was very difficult for testing when all that data needed to go up. Everything's running really well right now. It's looking really good. The servers, we virtualized all of our servers. We have 23 virtual machines running on two new Dells now. One's at the Kingswood campus and one's at the SAU. Those 23 servers are on both servers, but they're split up. Some are running here and some are running here. The ones that are running are replicating back to the ones that aren't. So if the server goes down, we'll be able to bring up all of those. Yeah, it's awesome. I'm so excited. I'm telling you, what a load up. We also just recently, actually, just over this last break, we got a really nice backup and recovery solution in place, which is another load up. And it's really nice. So we're backing up all of those servers now to a data storage, a small data storage at the SAU, and that replicates to another data storage at the Kingswood campus. So we have two backups of our backups plus our servers that are replicating. So logo. With the data increase, that has been great. The switching, I replaced all the switches with HP Aruba switches, guaranteed for life. So one's go, I'm telling you, one goes down, we call them up, we get a brand new one the next day. It's really good. The firewall, we have a 40-gate firewall. We have the sandbox running on the firewall, which is not something we had before. The sandbox, the firewall inspects all of the packets, all of the data that comes in on the fly. If it thinks anything suspicious, it sends it to the sandbox, and it'll run it on the sandbox. And if it's malware, if it's anything, it just dumps it right there. It doesn't come in. 100% preventative, and probably not. Right, firewalls and police departments, where they're always a step behind, so nature of the game. What are you going to do? But that's really nice, having that running. We had that running. We checked it 5 minutes after that we started it up, and it had scanned 25,000 files, and it had done 600 of them. So that felt pretty good. Let's see. What else have we got going? The software that's running on the servers, I've been really afraid of ransomware, and we heard all the stories from other districts. Sophos has, I meant to look this up, Intercept X or X Intercept, I always mess it up. it sees the signature of ransomware, and it can stop the ransomware, and it can actually roll back the encrypted files. And that's running on all of our servers right now. Which is another, it's good. Right now that's just on the servers, but we may move that out to some of the more important PCs in the district. You guys probably, just in case. Let's see, voice over IP phones. We have them installed here in Ossipee. They were installed in Tuftonboro over the Christmas break. So the Tuftonboro phones actually run through the system here. We're able to do just extension, four-digit extension dialing from Ossipee, Tuftonboro, the high school, middle school, and Crescent Lake right now. So there's no nine outside line. You can just pick up and do extension dialing. So we're moving along there. For infrastructure, what we're working on right now is actually rewiring the old elementary schools. A lot of the cabling in the old elementary schools we found a little late, but a lot of them are Cat 5. Cat 5 data lines only run at 100 megabytes. We need at least Cat 5E. So we're looking at, I have bids to start rewiring the New Durham School over the summer break for all Cat 6. It's also an E-rate eligible item, so I mean we'll get the federal reimbursement for that, which is really good. So we'll move that out as we go along for the rest of the elementary. So we have to evaluate this building for sure, Carpenter. We're getting there with that. Security camera systems. We have them, the Access security camera systems. They're district wide. So there's systems running right now in all of our schools. You can access all of these systems from all of the schools. So if there's an incident, you would be able to sit right and see what's happening and help direct, and it's good. Access control systems, the door system swipe cards has been replaced. Ours went down at the Kingswood complex sometime back. That's back up and running and has been replaced. It's going to be moving into Carpenter School over the summer. We'll be doing Carpenter and then moving that up for the rest of the district pretty quickly. I think that will go pretty good. This is all because we're connected now. The system that we put in for access control at the Kingswood campus, I think if I remember right, they told me it can handle 16,000 readers. This same system is running in, and it was one of the less expensive models. This is running down in schools down in Gloucester, and they're running an incredible amount of doors and security controls and So well, it'll manage the system really good, this district here. I think, honestly, that's oh, data privacy. We move forward with the data governance and the data privacy. We've been doing a lot of work on that. We rolled it out over right after the Christmas break, and we've created forms for staff, faculty, and staff to submit and get used to doing all of this now. We're going to start the actual blocking of the ones that aren't being signed the start of the following school year, next September. Because one of the big ones is Adobe. And so we have Adobe Creative Cloud, and they refused to sign New Hampshire's data privacy agreement. And they also made a change with their software that you can't use the software unless you log in. You have to log in with your email address, which is personally identifiable information for students. We can't do it. There's a lot of people that use that and require contact at the high school and several other classes that use that. I've been working with them. I'm trying to get them to free up what they call a feature-restricted license. They won't give it to us. They say they'll only let government institutions use it. I'm hoping I can convince them that that's what we are. And if I can get the feature-restricted licensing, it works the way it always used to. There's a license on the computer. You don't need an internet connection. You can use the software. Elsewise, we're going to have to try and find something that can do the job. It's difficult. It's been difficult. I really believe the whole what we're going through right now with the data privacy agreements is probably will go away in 5 years. Because all of these app builders and the extensions and all of this, the websites, they're going to lose the public education market if they don't start complying. So it's difficult now. I do see it going away, but we're moving along. We have our website up. We have a large list. We're keeping our inventory of what's there.
Paul, how many of these would you say you've had to vet? Like hundreds, right?
I think we're up to around 300. And it takes a while, you know. We're not doing it ourselves. We joined the NHCTO Council, and the NHCTO Council joined the Student Data Privacy Alliance. And so through those, we're able to submit our apps, extensions, or whatever to them, and they have the lawyers on staff that are then going back and forth with the companies and the app builders and getting these documents signed. And it's taking somewhere to 2 weeks to 2 months. I mean, we're still waiting on some that are maybe 2.5 months. So it's very difficult for faculty and staff, you know, to find something really cool and exciting and want to jump right in and start using it. It's kind of putting a damper on that. We're trying to speed it up, but there's not a real lot we can do. And a lot of these, you get back to some of the folks that won't sign because they're, you know, it's Bob in his garage who had a really cool idea and came up with this awesome app that works for everything, but he doesn't have the legal staff. And we actually have a lot of responses like that. We just can't do it. And it's a free app, and they make their money by the marketing, the advertisement, and getting the data collected. So, but we're moving forward.
I think this gives you an idea of the kind of progress that's been made in IT. It's just incredible. Just a few years ago, we had lots of trouble with testing. We couldn't complete. We had to have kids test in stages. We couldn't run all the software at the same time in buildings. And we have come light years. Light years. Paul has just done an amazing job. And you can also tell by some of the things that Paul talked about tonight how intertwined security has become with technology, the sweat cards, the cameras for safety, and the voiceover. That's also another safety feature. So I, you know, with Paul working with other parts of our school district to get our schools more secure, it really gives me more of a sense of comfort, and I'm really happy that we're going to be able to do the swipe cards in all of our schools, because that's going to make each school more, even more secure than they are now. So it's terrific. And the other thing I want to mention is I know that Paul is very cost conscious, so when we talk about something and I say, well, how much is that going to cost, Paul? And he'll say, well, I researched this and I researched that, and this is the cheapest, and this is, so, and but this is the most effective, and so I can always count on him to get the best quality for the best deal, which is really great. So it's just, you know, kudos, Paul. You've just done so much great work in this area, in the district, and I know that, I'm sure every teacher appreciates it, and I do as well. So thank you very much.
Mr. Chair, may I ask a quick question, please?
Yes, sir.
The apps and that organization that you mentioned that vets the apps, mm-hmm. do they look at what some of the apps may be pulling from the student information?
Oh, yes.
Is that what they're looking for? Because
yep.
that's what I worried about years ago.
Yep.
Back then,
oh, yeah.
you didn't know what they were collecting.
Yep.
So they vet the whole program and
yes.
make sure that it is not pulling the information from
right.
the third
party. And using any of that data. One of the big things is using the data for... it's for marketing. So if they get the email, the data, and then they can find the Facebook, they can do this, they can do that, they can start pushing all of this data, using this data to direct the marketing across those platforms, Facebook and the rest of it, which is what they're trying to stop. So that is a big one.
Smart. One follow-up. Now, Google is known for collecting a huge amount of information without telling us.
Right.
Now, you use a Google system.
Yep.
Is that also vetted by that same organization?
Google for Education is different than the Google that you use. And Google does follow the privacy laws that they have to follow for the Google for Education portion.
Well, that makes me very happy.
Yeah,
last question. Does the school run a VPN to its servers and everything, or do you?
We do not. Could be, right, yes and no. Let me. I can't say that. We're connected with dark and lit fiber right now. The high school campus, the SAU, Carpenter, and Crescent Lake are on dark fiber. We own that fiber. That was done during the renovation, so we're the only ones on it. The lit fiber is the rest of the schools going back there, which is data that we rent. We rent a lit line. There are other people on it, but we have two fiber lines, one for going out, one for coming back. And then there's magic in between. There's a lot going on with the lit fiber to get it there. So, in answer to your question, the communication coming from all of the elementary schools back is all running on a private network, the private IP range, A, B, and C, class A, B, and C, in none of the public ranges. So we don't need the VPNs anymore because they are actually physically, not physically, that's not the right word, they are part of our network. They're our network. When you come in, if you get the guest Wi-Fi password, if you come in and connect to our Wi-Fi, GWRFD, I don't know your device, I don't know anything about it. You get connectivity, but only to the outside world. Because your device on that network, the password that I give you, is firewalled right at the APs. You can't even come into our building. When I'm working from home, I connect to the firewall with a VPN. The HVAC guys, when they need to connect, it's through a VPN. We set them up some time back. Any of the vendors that need access to stuff like the HVAC and things like that, they can only do it with a VPN that we set up.
Very good. Thank you.
Yep.
Thank you.
I have a question.
Thanks, Paul.
May I ask a question, even though it's not public? So the police do drills in the school, and they prepare for active shooters. They prepare for a variety of emergencies. So you have all the surveillance cameras, and so you are able to see where an incident is happening. How do the police connect to that so they can see it? Do they have to come to the campus, or can they do it?
I would think that they would have to coordinate with our SRO back at the Kingswood campus. That would be my guess.
Do you know if they can? Can they connect so they can see what's happening right
away? The SRO has, our school resource officer has connectivity to the camera system.
The local police department can't check on cameras.
Right.
There's no direct link to the police department at this point.
Right.
anymore.
All right, thank you so much,
Paul. Thank you.
Thank you
very much. Okay.
Very
informative.
They do an incredible job. And then think about the number of staff members in this district and the amount of equipment. There's a lot on the plate of all of those people. And Paul just does a great job, you know. Whenever there's something on his plate that's an emergency and he has to drop whatever he's doing, he's like, oh yeah, that's, you know, I expect that, that's fine. He's just so great about it all.
Thank you, Paul.
Thank you, Paul. Yeah, he is amazing, just amazing. And just the most even temperament while he's spinning any number of plates. So.
I know a little bit about IT, and when he's saying that, well, I changed a bunch of 10-100 switches out. Well, I thought they should have been changed out years ago, because we changed them out of work years ago to gigabyte switches. But it's great that we're moving forward.
Yeah, he's just been amazing. All right, next is the 21st Century Community Learning Center's Schools Out Survey, and there are a couple of things here. One is the results from last year's survey, and the results, as they are every year, were very positive. I don't know if you all had a chance to look at them, but you know, it's a really wonderful program, and the students respond extremely well and positively to all questions. A few things that stood out to me, only because these particular things I know really make a difference in the lives of kids. And the first thing is that all of the students responding said that the adults in the program cared about them. And I know that's a very significant thing for kids. I know that's very, very important. Every student said they liked the program all or most of the time, which is great. You get a kid that likes anything all or most of the time is pretty good. And then 15 out of 16 students said that there was at least one adult that they could talk to most or all of the time. And then one student said that there was an adult that they could talk to some of the time. So that's the other thing that you see in the research literature about the importance of kids connecting with an adult. So for me, those three really stood out. So attached to this is, it's time to conduct another survey. And so the program is looking for the board's approval for the survey so that we can continue to receive the grant. And I don't think there's any doubt that it's a fantastic program and the kids really benefit from it, both socially, emotionally, and also academically. I think it makes a difference in their academic progress as well. So. I know we'd like to continue to
see
it.
Same questions as from before.
Same questions, yeah.
I'll make a motion to approve the questionnaire.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded to continue producing the Schools Out survey, moving forward with that. Any other questions or concerns?
How is this going to be used?
How is the survey going to be used?
How is the survey?
It's used in order for it to be grant funded. So when the grant proposals are evaluated, this is looked at. And I imagine that if most of the kids said they didn't like the program and if they didn't have, or do you mean internally?
I meant internally.
Internally?
Yeah. So there's like one of the questions do you get to be a leader?
Mm-hmm.
So if I was looking at this and going through it as a staff in it, I'd be saying, oh, well, these ratings were a little lower. What can we do or what can we implement in our programs to slide those over to the other?
Yeah. The coordinator of the program, Jen Berkowitz, does that. She goes through and looks at everything and then makes a determination of what things should happen as a result of the survey.
And then she reports it back to you?
No, she just puts it into action.
Any other questions?
Second.
Okay.
What'd you see? Was there any questions?
Any other questions, yeah.
No.
All right, all those in favor of continuing with the Schools Out survey, signal by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Chair votes aye. Excellent. Thank you.
Okay, and next up is a request for support for Camp Invention through the Wood Estate. You'll see that the Camp Invention amount is $9,785, and this is similar to the request that we've had the last several years for Wood Estate money in order to run Camp Invention. I certainly support this. If you look at, based on the policy, we're able to spend 3% of the total amount, and 3% of the total amount equals a little bit over $21,000, so it's $21,359. So even with the use of the $9,785, we still have about $11,500 left for other things that we might want to fund prior to the end of the school year. So, and we may get yet another request. I know Crescent Lake and Carpenter are fortunate to have a donor that supports this, but Tufton Borough may be requesting some money, so I just need to see what Ryan has planned. And then any additional amount, I would be encouraging the guidance counselor at the high school to submit for scholarships for students.
Make a motion to approve the request from the Wood Estate.
Second. Okay, moved and seconded to approve the request for the Wood Estates for the Camp Invention program. Any other questions or concerns? All those in favor, signal by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Chair votes aye. Thank you.
Okay, next. The next topic is a big topic. I know you've all been seeing this constantly in the media, probably to the point where you became tired of hearing it. But I was away for the vacation week. So I really got up to speed on Sunday night. When I got up to speed on Sunday night, I knew that I had to do some things pretty quickly on Monday. So I think you all saw a letter from me that went out on Monday. And I just would like to review a little bit of that. I just wanted to inform parents what was happening with the coronavirus, and that there were preventive measures that were being highly recommended. And so you saw what those were. A lot of them are common sense procedures, washing your hands, covering a cough or a sneeze with an elbow or tissue, immediately discarding the tissue, avoiding touching eyes, mouth, nose, avoiding close contact with individuals who are sick, keeping sick children at home, reporting a child's absence to the nurse, teaching a child not to share personal items, water bottles, food, etc. And clean and disinfect frequently touched objects and surfaces within your home. And then there are also additional measures if you've been traveling, and I won't go through all of those because you've probably heard them on the news. And as a result of all the information coming out and the fact that we're hearing about a spread, I knew I needed to keep up with the CDC and the New Hampshire Division of Public Health. So that's what I've been doing for the past while. Things changed by the following evening, and there was a travel warning. And if anyone had been, at that evening, it was China, Italy, South Korea, or Japan. And now, the following day, Iran was included. And so it was recommended that if you've been traveling to one of these countries, that you stop quarantine for 14 days after returning. So I wanted to make sure that parents had that. And the other thing is, we needed to put some procedures in place here too, because if we're asking parents to make sure that their children are doing all of these things and they're monitoring their kids, we want to make sure that things here are being sanitized. So you saw the long list of procedures that we've gone through as far as sanitizing every classroom every night. All the doorknobs, lunch tables, water fountains, bathrooms, etc. have a very aggressive sanitizing schedule anyway, so we didn't really need to do anything in addition to that. Teachers are being provided spray balls and sanitizers. Our buses are going to be sanitized daily. Coaches will also be reviewing procedures because I understand kids sometimes share things on the athletic field that they shouldn't. So, a good reminder. I've been in touch with Huggins Hospital, and Huggins is going to be providing a checklist for our school nurses. I don't think it's probably going to be anything school nurses don't already know, but nevertheless, it's nice to be collaborating and communicating with your local health care provider. On a final note, I'm really aware of how quickly things can change, and I think I've seen in the last day that the circles are getting closer to where we are. So I'd like to talk with you about a few things tonight, such as field trips, what we're going to do about field trips. This presents a real dilemma because the field trips we have for a purpose, and we want kids to be able to go on the field trips. On the other hand, some of the places where the kids will be going are highly populated areas. They'll be in close proximity with other students. And right now, I'm feeling pretty uncomfortable sending kids on any field trips. If you had asked me 5 days ago, I would have said, well, but now I'm just feeling very uncomfortable. So we've got, is this microphone helping or is it tinny?
No,
is it
yeah.
Helping? Okay, all right. It kind of feels weird to be talking to you through a microphone. So we've got one that was planning on going to the DoubleTree in Manchester, the Future Business Leaders of America, and that's in Manchester. And again, it's at a hotel. It'll be with other kids throughout the state. As much as I really want to say yes to this field trip, at this point, it's coming up soon. It's March 18th, and I'm not really feeling very good about it. So unless you tell me that I should let the kids go, I'm thinking that it's probably a good idea to just suspend that field trip.
It's it's so difficult. My personal opinion is, we probably shouldn't let them go. Obviously, that's the same location that they just had the Made in New Hampshire fair, the home show where hundreds of thousands of people go to the home show and they're all there last weekend or whatever. It's such a hard thing, but my feeling on these is at this point in time, I think we have to be more careful up front. It may be overreaction in the long run, but right now it's a safety issue, and I think we have to look on the safety side. My feeling.
That's the way I've been feeling about it.
You can't.
It's better. Yeah. I don't want to overreact. That's certainly not my style. But I also want our kids to be safe. And even though kids are not necessarily as susceptible as young kids through 15 are not as susceptible as older adults, they can still carry the germ, the virus, I should say. So we don't want anyone in families that are vulnerable to be getting sick either.
I'd much rather take the heat after the fact.
Yeah. And as much as you don't want to take, we're always really supportive of those experiences for our kids, taking it away from the small group of those versus the consequence of us having to step down a school is a much larger.
We've got one going to would have gone to the Technology Student Association in Waterville Valley. And, Waterville Valley seems pretty safe, except kids are coming from all over the state. So you just don't know.
Have you heard that maybe there's a possibility that some of these events will be canceled anyways?
I haven't heard anything about that yet. No. And we've got a few that are further out. So let's see. Dan?
Yes. I just want to add to you have a, you are in a difficult situation. You know, it's not like calling school off because of snow. People are going.
Well, I don't like that either.
Well, I was going to say, no. People are going to complain no matter what you do. You know, 50% are going to agree, 50% are going to probably disagree. Is there anything you need from us as a board to give you sanction, power, whatever? Sometimes you're going to have to make a decision on a Sunday night to cancel what school on a Monday.
Well, that comes next. That's the next thing I wanted to talk with you about, because I do want to have a discussion about that.
Because Newmarket had to do that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. As far as field trips go, those that are a little further out, we've got one at Brenton. We've got one at Fenway Park, and that's the 28th of May. I wouldn't send kids to Fenway Park right now. Who knows what's going to happen by the 28th of May? Maybe things will have diminished by then. I don't know. So I don't want to make a blanket decision at this point and say no field trips for the rest of the year. That doesn't seem quite right either. But for this period of time, while we're seeing things grow, I think it might be wise for me to not authorize field trips.
I think that's a good idea. And yeah. You know, obviously, maybe things may change between now and May, but between now and the 1st of April or the middle of April, I think we just have to be very cautious about what we do. And, you know, as much as it hurts, I think we just have to take that position.
Yeah. And I think I'd like to have this on the agenda again in April so we can talk about it, we can track where things have been and where it looks like they're going. So that if we can allow, if I can allow field trips, then I certainly will. But, Krista?
I wonder if principals should be sharing our thinking around this with the faculty. Just because if they have traditional things that they've done with the kids over the years. So that everybody's excited about going to the Museum of Science.
Right.
You know, that they can try to be coming up with some other alternative or at least approaching that so the hit isn't quite as hard and the teachers have a way to think about how to address it.
I think that's a great idea. I do have a list of all the field trips from each school for the rest of the year. So I think that would be a great topic for the principals. Because I agree, you know, especially some of those activities are culminating activities, like the Museum of Science field trip, and that would be one of the worst because so many things are hands-on there. So, but they're going to be really disappointed. It's a really great trip for them, so to try to do something that's fun, that's an alternative, I think is a great idea.
You know, and if they hear loud and clear that they may be able to go if things appear to be subsiding a bit, well, that's one thing, but otherwise, they need to think about it.
Great idea. Thank you. And then the next topic was, things changed pretty quickly with this virus, and I feel as though it would be wise for me to have the authority to close school if I see that someone, I can't even describe exactly the situation that I would want to make that decision in. There could be a number of reasons why I might want to make that decision. I certainly would do it with the Department of Health and Human Services Public Health Office in New Hampshire. I certainly wouldn't decide, flip a coin and decide, or just say, well, I think I'll do this because this is what I think. I would definitely be watching everything on the CDC website and also be looking at, not looking at, but talking with the folks from public health. But I wouldn't want to have to wait to have a meeting. I think if it needs to be done, it needs to be done. I have spoken with Lise Tierney because my thinking around this is that kids need to have something to be doing if they're out of school. So it makes sense maybe to have kids online, and that way they would be occupied. And our teachers have been pretty good at putting things together for Blizzard Bag Days. Now I know this is a different level. But I want to give them a little bit of time, maybe a couple of days, to get some lessons ready. And then they would, just like they prepare now for the next day, the Blizzard Bag Days are shorter days, so they would be able to prepare that day for the next day.
Granted, it will be, it certainly will be a lot for them, but I think that Lee certainly was very supportive, and I think it's a better way to go with the kids, and also we wouldn't have to make those days up. I'd be looking for the Department of Education to give us a waiver. Would I expect that the teacher's lessons will be perfect? No, I wouldn't. But I still think it's the better alternative. So I also wanted to make sure that you all felt okay about that.
I think we need to look at what do we do with those few children that don't have internet access? How do we handle them? How do we get any information to them or other work papers to them to work on as one of the pieces? And the other thing with this, obviously, it's very difficult, obviously, for the teachers to do the preparation, but it's going to be just as hard for the parents who adjust their lives to keep their children home and do that as well. So this is it's a drastic measure. Something we have to prepare for, but not just the internet access. I think we have to have some way of handling those students that don't have internet access. Hopefully most everybody does, but there are some areas that just don't have good coverage, and there's
most of the town of Brookfield doesn't have.
Well, there you go. I mean, any of the students that are out there, we have to just have a mechanism to get the students the work that they need to do so they don't fall behind the other students. So those pieces have to be looked at. But yeah, I think to my feeling is you do whatever preparation we possibly do to make it happen if it should have to come to that. So you want an official motion on this? Sure. I think I take a motion to give the superintendent authority to close the schools in case an emergency arises where it's necessary to do it.
So moved.
It's been moved and seconded to give the superintendent the authority to close the schools if necessary. Any other input? Okay, all those in favor, signify saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Chair votes aye as well.
Thank you. Hopefully you won't have to.
Yes. Yes, Dana.
Just to add a little bit of knowledge that I didn't know, Huggins Hospital is up and running. They have the test. They have to send it out, probably to the state, so there might be a lag time of a few hours, but they're able to take anybody with the symptoms of coronavirus. You can go to Huggins. And Huggins, I did not know, has two isolated rooms for viral infection. So we do have something close by.
We had a conversation about that. I had a conversation about that with Jeremy Roberge. And so we have a protocol if we need to send anyone to the emergency department, which is we'll just call ahead, make sure they know that the person's coming. Same thing if there's a family member that we know of, we'll let them know that and counsel the family member to go to the emergency department. And he did mention that I think they're called negative pressure rooms. So it's good. They have a task force working on it, which is great. Thank you, Dan. Okay, and I think the last thing is legislative update. And as far as that goes, there's going to be the crossover for the House and Senate is on March 26th. And many bills have been found inexpedient to legislate, but I'll have more information for you when we meet next time about your other stand and what looks like it's going to pass and not pass. So it'll be something a little bit more extensive at the April board meeting. Okay.
School Board Association, we have a meeting next Wednesday night. Starting at 4:30, we're interviewing four new board members, potentially from around the state, which is good because you have three members going off the board. One is timed out, who can be on the board for 12 years, and the other two are not running for re-election again, so they're also, we're losing three and hopefully gaining four. And then our regular board meeting starts at 5:45 next Wednesday, and it's the opportunity that we get to meet with representatives from our U.S. delegation, the two senators and the two representatives from their offices.
to find out what's happening from Washington's standpoint, and ask them questions and concerns about what we may have on our minds as well, that they can take back to the senators and to our representatives. So this is always a good meeting for us, because we do get a chance to find out some of what's happening down in Washington, and if anything is actually moving in any direction at all. So hopefully we'll find out some of that next Wednesday. And that's all I have for that. From on the chairman's side, we had some expressions of sympathy sent to Kelly Colby Seavey on the passing of her father-in-law, and Kristen Johnson on the passing of her grandmother. So those are the, yes.
Her father-in-law used to work for the district. Is it good
then? I don't know that for sure. Kelly Colby Seavey's father-in-law.
Not that I know of, Kristen.
Okay. Not sure. Okay, that's all I've got. So let's go to committee reports. Academic Affairs has a lot on the agenda this evening.
Yes, we did. And Heather just took us through it in lightning speed. So if you look at this, what you'll see is the first thing that we're looking at is the bus driver drug-free policy, which the committee gave to you before, and so we're looking for approval on it. And if you remember from our discussions before, the thing that was most beneficial out of this new policy is that it would, when we go to hire people, we can check on their background now within the state, and this allows us to check with other states. So if they're applying to work here and they've been in Massachusetts, we can have a background check done that way. I think that was, at least from my perspective, the most significant thing there.
It'll be a phase in. We'll run a dual system for a bit until the clearinghouse is fully operational, but you've got it.
Thank you. So, should we take a motion to...
Sure. Look for a motion then to approve EEAEAA.
Any other
questions? All those in favor, signal by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Chair votes aye as well.
This is fun. Now, the next policy that we'd like you to look at and hopefully get approval from is the work that's been done, I understand, for about a year or so on the interscholastic athletic policy. And we went through the changes from at our last meeting, so we're ready for the overall approval of it. And there were obviously some adjustments made predominantly around sports teams beginning and then being reviewed, and then how long they needed to be sustained. And the other big piece of that, if you look at the policy in your packet, was number 6 in looking at how many years it takes before the district takes over the full funding of it. Mm-hmm. So those were the two major changes.
I think it's a great change. Finally, took a while to get there.
It can take time sometimes.
Because I look for a motion then to approve JJIDD.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, moved and seconded to approve policy JJIBB as presented. All signal by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Chair votes aye. Thank you.
Okay, the next policy, if you look, it's the DAF policy, the Administration of Federal Grant Funds. And this is the first reading of this policy. And in looking at it, I felt like when Heather was sharing this with us, and this has been handed to us to deal with, she spent a great deal of time looking at this and aligning our current practices with the policies. So we have a number of practices which needed to be checked off, so to speak, and put into the federal language and that's probably the biggest part of it. We had the practices and we had our approaches and we've always been in compliance with things, but this formalizes our current practices. And it consolidates a number of our current policies in one place. So what, so those are the major what it does. It's obviously we do these things to receive our federal monies and word things the way they like. So I would ask that, since this is really, I believe, a first read of this, that if you have any questions about it, you can address them. I'm going to say this and be quite sincere about it. Address them to Heather, because sort of like the language that they use in here is just amazing to me, and I would have had to receive it a month ago in order to try to understand some of what is in here. So if anyone does, and you could like write yourself notes so when we come back for our next read, you can do that. Is that all right with the world?
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Then we go on to a policy, which is referred to as fixed assets. Had to be really careful about that one. So on our fixed assets, and it's DID. It's an inventory of practices that we have, and those things are then put into policy terminology. So it really formalizes what we are already doing. It's not that we have to do anything differently. It's not that it's going to cost us any money. We have just put it into federalese. So if you would take the time and look that over and bring questions back for the next reading, that would be very helpful. As is the next one, which is referred to as purchasing. And again, it really formalizes the practices that we already have in place and puts it into the federal terminology that has been requested. And again, I would ask you to look it over if you have any questions and bring those back. If you look at the next one, which is the data records and retention. These policies are really fluid policies, and for board members and people that have the packet, if you're looking at it, you can see on the EHR, the first page of that, you go down to the middle, and there are some, in blue, some changes that needed to be revised and incorporated. And so other than that, if you have questions, bring them back for our next reading. The employment reference and verification, this is the first reading for this. And this really calls and articulates and set up guidelines for the district that if someone calls the district asking for a reference on someone that's applied for a job within their district, it gives us sort of the guidelines of what you can and cannot say about that person. So we'd also obviously would therefore know what we can ask other districts in reverse. So this gives us the guidelines to follow around that. And we will pick that up at our next available date. The eighth one is the drug-free workplace and drug-free schools. Now, we had, if you have the packet, we had a drug-free workplace policy in place. And when Heather got this policy, it sounded like she spent a great deal of time trying to reconcile our policy with the federal policy. And after spending and investing quite a bit of time, she realized that it would be much easier and more efficient and effective to adapt the policy that was sent instead of looking at what rolled in and what didn't roll in. So it's a total redo instead of the current policies because of all how many changes there would be. So if you look under the GBEC, you can see that just about everything has everything, not just about everything, but everything has a red line through it saying we would be doing away with this policy and replacing it with the next policy that follows immediately. Any questions for Heather?
Like how I did that?
But we'll get back to you.
Thank you.
Look
forward to it.
Good job.
Thank you.
Good job. Okay, so we got a lot of reading to do and all between now and next meeting, too.
Yes, because we want to get these right off our docket.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Okay. Thank you. Building and maintenance. Anything?
No, Joanne's not here tonight, but she had requested a meeting. I don't know if you've gotten back to her.
I've gotten back to everyone saying it's going to be April 6th. I mean,
April
the agenda's 6th. Already up. Yep. So
next meeting. Yeah, 6 o'clock before our next meeting.
Okay.
Yeah. Excellent.
Sorry, it's been a while.
No worries. You may help me in email.
Just one thing, building and maintenance. Sarah was giving us an update of monthly emergency expenditure.
A monthly update, yes. And I received it today, so I haven't had a chance. I had questions on it that I wanted to get the answers before I emailed you all the update. Because if you have the questions, I'll have the answers. But that'll come tomorrow. Yep, she was a few days late on that. She apologized.
Okay. Under finance, nothing other than get out and vote tomorrow. And if you have town meetings coming up, if you're in those kind of towns, attend those and be part of the process. I have nothing under human resources. Advanced planning, if you look down below, the two things listed, no school tomorrow, obviously, for voting. And our next meeting is April 6th at Carpenter School. And 6 o'clock for building and maintenance, and 7 o'clock school board meeting at Carpenter School. Public input. Yes?
Jack, I just wanted to, I know that it seemed like there was a little bit more question about the schools out survey, and I just wanted you to know that there is, there's a leadership board and also an advisory board that also reviews the results of that survey. And so we do review that to approve the program and to highlight what's working well. So Jen does go back, Jennifer Berkowitz, the program director, and reviews that with her staff as well. So I just wanted to answer that a little bit more.
Great. Thank you very much. Any other public input? Okay. Closing comments by board members. I'm going to go first. Only because this is Stacy's last board meeting with us, and I just want to thank you for all your efforts and everything you've done for the board over the years on the board. It's been a pleasure to work with you, and I wish you well in the future. So thank you.
Well, thank you. The pleasure's been mine. So I'll go next then.
Okay. go right ahead.
So I'll say, what a great meeting to end on. I mean, sad to be my last meeting. It's bittersweet, but what a great night we had. The pasta, car thing, that touched on so many different aspects of learning, and it was just a great presentation. That looks like they really had a lot of fun with it. We talked about state education funding, that I know just enough about IT to know that we're making strides in the right direction, and to know that those are important things we're doing. So we'll leave it at that. And I could just go, you know, point by point, that the outcomes from the after-school program here. There was a response in here I really liked about the confidence, self-confidence, or I feel like I can go do good things in the future. I mean, that alone. You know, okaying funds from the Wood Estate to support our students during the summer for STEM education. And we finally took some final action on the interscholastic athletics policy. So that was great. So that's a positive. But thank you. It's really been a pleasure and a privilege working with all of you, and to say keep up the good work as we move forward.
Thank you.
I'll be voting in favor of everything.
Dr. Jim.
We're going this way?
Sure.
Stacy, thank you. You and I came on the board together.
Yeah.
And we slogged through a lot of stuff in between, but it's been a pleasure to be with you. Hey, Andrea, that was a cool exhibit. I'll tell you, those kids were terrific. I loved their exhibition, particularly the part about cooperation. That was cool. Everybody get out and vote tomorrow. It's your civic duty, you need to get there. You know, if you don't do it now, we'll never get another chance, so do it.
Well, certainly Andrea and staff, thank you. It was fantastic. And certainly going into all the schools, the different programs that they show us is fantastic. What I really liked about this, it was so hands-on. Mm-hmm. I'm a hands-on learner, so to see that they were, you know, it incorporated so much, like you had said, mm-hmm. Stacy, but they were really getting right into the nitty-gritty and doing it. So that was fantastic. And I did make it to the lip sync. That was fantastic. I'm not sure why you guys didn't get more points.
It was a tough day.
Yeah. let's see. And not that you have to comment on it right now, and certainly I kind of assumed the direction that it's going to go. But as far as the student and staff sharing overseas, I haven't heard any more, so I didn't know where that stands.
I can't. Ashley, I'm glad you asked that question, because this month we got our CFIS certification, so we are certified to take students from overseas. We won't be taking them this year. but actually, our plan wasn't to take them until a year from now anyway. So I have to say, though, I am thankful that we don't have any teachers over there right now, because their schools have been closed. I did want to mention that Kim Kelleher's class sent a video from her students over to say, hang in there, you know, this will pass. And so she really enjoyed that. It was a really cool project for the kids. So yes, we're still on track. We're still, I met recently with our connection, and things are on track.
Fantastic. Thank you. And lastly, Stacy, thank you for everything. You certainly helped me on the board. I've looked up to you. Certainly having kids in the school system at the same time, it was great, but thank you very much.
All right. Well, first I want to say, if Elon Musk finds out what you can do with lasagna, the car industry will not be safe, and we'll all be hungry. Full disclosure, I want to say Jen Berkowitz is my stepdaughter. So I want to testify that her enthusiasm for the after-school program is genuine and quite enthusiastic. So hopefully all that's involved in that will continue forward in a positive manner. And Stacy, I can't say anything because I haven't been here long. But you seem like a nice person. Good. And then lastly, yes, there's an election tomorrow, and I'm on the ballot. And barring any vigorous write-in campaign, I expect a landslide victory because I'm unopposed. And I'm really looking forward to the next couple of years being with this group.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Krista?
Nothing excites me more than to watch kids learn and to watch kids be able to articulate what they have learned. And that's just different. That whole awareness of what they were doing, finding out what the issues were, and then problem solving it, making the changes, and going ahead with it. That was really wonderfully exciting. So that just made my month. That was really wonderful. The other things I want to say relate to vocabulary, and I don't seem to have one when it comes to really understanding all of the parts about the amicus brief. Now, I got the general understanding about that, but it would be good for me for someone to maybe walk me through it a little more slowly so I could absorb different pieces of it, because I have a gut reaction to what I think we should maybe do about it, but I'm not sure, and I just have more questions than answers.
I think if he sends us the brief beforehand, before our next meeting, which he's going to do, then we'll be able to at least read the whole thing to try to understand it better for all of us, and then we can discuss that.
Because I found it fascinating, but it's just so, it's not in my wheelhouse of knowledge and understanding, so it just, for me to concentrate at my age that hard on that. And the other thing is, when I worked at the middle school, Paul was stationed at the middle school, and you always knew Paul was there because, if you don't know it, he is a whistler. He is an incredible whistler, but you can, you know when he's working really hard, when he really, really is whistling. And that poor man's pucker right now must be something, because I was amazed when he was going through everything that they've done. Even, I mean, just since the beginning of the year when we talked to him, and you know, we've seen come over our computers. This program's approved, this program is not approved, and so I felt like I was keeping up with it that way, but all the other things he was talking about, just really, and if you're not a techie, it's hard to understand all of it, because it's just so overwhelming, but I really feel very secure with Paul at the head of that. And I really like the questions around security for our kids. And I like Paul being able to say, well, Google for Education is different than Google for everybody else. And that he felt very, very good that it was a secure program to be using. So that was very good.
Dana.
Thank you very much for hosting the meeting tonight, and the classroom teacher and the students did so well in their presentation. And it was nice to see how lessons in the STEM program can be put together. So many lessons were involved in this experiment, and not only were STEM courses involved, but also the personal skills, working together, making decisions, and sometimes putting up with people destroying your projects. But anyways, so thank you again. And Stacy, thank you very much for all the work. And especially in OSPE, the after-school program with Berkowitz. It's always been a success, and it's nice to see it in print. Students returning a survey and how they were encouraged by the program and liked it. And last of all, I'm going to contact the athletic department to get some shoulder pads for our superintendent. But having to, it's unbelievable, things that come up, emergencies, and things that just add more to your day and decision making. So again, thank you and the assistant superintendent, take it, and anybody else that's involved in making the decisions that have not been easy in the last month or so. So thanks again.
Okay, Connor, anything?
I loved impasta cards. I'm a big fan of those. I loved when, I don't remember their true names, but when they got up and they were talking about how their car ran into some problems and how they were able to learn from their mistakes.
Yeah.
I thought that was great. I wasn't able to do that until I was like 15 and doing it in sixth grade. I think it was brilliant. And thank you, Stacy. Wish you the best of luck.
Thank you.
So.
Thank you.
Most everything has been said, but I also want to say the pasta card was really cool. And also, this past weekend, I went to see the high school competition play, the Yeehaw Review.
Oh, yeah.
And they did a really good job. It was really good. So good luck to them in the competition.
Okay. Anyone else? You don't have to.
Okay. The only thing I would mention, and I didn't think of it, Ed, when you were speaking about the stakeholders meeting, but I think the school district had four members represented there. We had, I believe, Jeff Bunting was there, Andrea was there, our other social worker from the high school was there. And we may have to have one other person, and our homeless liaison, perhaps, she wasn't there. Okay. So, and I really feel like there was quite a response to the fire. I was on the phone a lot over that the course of that time, and the school really, really rallied. And you know, I can tell you if there's an invitation for the school to participate, we'll definitely make sure that someone is there. So
there was so much stuff donated; they don't know what to do.
Yeah, I believe it. I believe it. I think the community response was incredible. And the care that I heard in those phone calls that I got from the middle school to high school and Ossipee were just, and transportation jumped to it to provide services to get families wherever they needed to go. So it was a real coordinated effort, and it just goes to show that I think the heart that people have for our kids in Ossipee. So. And Stacy, I'm going to miss you a lot. So, I wish you were staying.
Okay, I'll entertain a motion to go into non-public under RSA 91A, /3, paragraph 2, for legal and personal matters.
So moved. Second.
Moved and seconded. Dana?
Yes.
Crystal?
Yes.
James?
Yes.
Tim?
Yes.
Dr. Jim?
Yep.
Stacy?
Yes.
I guess we're in. Thank you.